Culture is the most advanced, the most civilized, the most prosperous, the most stable culture in the history of the world. And Reconstruction chips away at it. It's a steady flow of belittling comments. I'm not trying to explain how this would work. I'm very much in the political ground, political world, held political office for 9 years. I deal with hundreds and hundreds, literally thousands of people in political office. And in both politics and history, we see Reconstruction a whole lot. And here's how it works. I'm in a little town of Toledo. You know, we now have 20,000 in our town. But let's say in our town, a group gets together and they say, we're going to build a skyscraper. We're going to build a 100-story skyscraper. We're going to put everybody in Toledo to work. They're going to have a job and have one. It's going to be high-tech facility. It's going to be state-of-the-art. It's going to be a luxurious working. So this is going to happen. But let's say there's a group who doesn't like this new skyscraper that's going to be built. How can they keep that skyscraper from being successful? If we get it built, how can they keep it from being populated, being working? It's real simple. What they'll do is they'll find a bunch of experts and they'll come in and talk about the skyscraper. If I were on the other side, here's what I'd do. I would go in and take a tour of the skyscraper, and then over the next several weeks, I'd start a series of press releases. And I'd start saying, well, you know, we had our psychologist tour the building with us, and we noticed that the color pattern they used in lobby at the third floor is a series of combinations that psychologists tell us cause workplace depression. So as a result of working in this building, it's likely we have a lot of suicides in this building. As a matter of fact, I don't know why anybody would want to work here, because you probably want to go home and kill yourself after the color combination work. And so I'll do a press release on that. Then about a week later, I wrote a press release and said, you know, I have a structural engineer who's dwelling with me when we were on the 42nd floor. We noticed that one of the windows there was out of square. And that's just a reflection of the overall shoddy workmanship that is in this structure. It is so poorly built. We're probably going to have people falling out of the windows all over the structure. When any of these windows fall, it's going to kill people who work here. And I'm going to go up on the 67th floor, and I'm going to have someone go through it with me. We're going to say, you know, and notice over here that the women's restrooms don't have enough stalls. See, that indicates pervading sexism that dominates plenty of people who built this building. They have absolutely no regard for the working condition. And now we'll go up on the 82nd floor and tour it and say, look at the size of this office right here. I'll find the smallest office in the building. See that office right there? That is oppressive. Nobody would want to work in an office that small. That's a reflection of the oppressive mentality of big business against the American work. So what's going to happen is out of 100 floors, I'm going to find one lobby that I'd like to close in. Out of 50,000 windows, I'm going to find one that's out of square. Out of 500 bathroom stalls, I'm going to find one that I said doesn't have enough stalls. And out of 10,000 offices, I'm going to find one that I think is too small. And I'm going to do press releases about that. And I'm going to make sure the whole community knows how terrible this building is. That is the instructions. I won't point out all the good things. I'll point out the exception, not the rule. And that's what we've done in history. We've gotten into this thing of pointing out the exceptions, not the rule. We just won't talk about the good things. There's a lot of examples of this. Let me take you to this idea about tearing down these Western values. Now, let me show you. This is a popular school book. It's called Don't Know Much About History. It's supposed to be history for dummies. We don't know much about history. And so Kenneth Davis in this book goes through and tells us a lot of little tidbits about American history. We get into the American Revolution, we find this page. Say you want a revolution. American Voices, Patrick Henry, to the House of Burgesses here in Virginia. Is life so dear, peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of change and slavery? I know, of course, others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death. Great patriotism. Oh, by the way, see the ellipses in there? There's a little three-eyed ellipse. I wonder what they took out. Oh, it was real simple. They left four words out. Forbid it, Almighty God. His reference to God is what the ellipse is almost longer than the four words are. I mean, don't tell me, look at the space, the quiet space, plenty of space to put that in. And we're not going to talk about God. That's one of those Western values that we don't want. So we're going to make history look really secular. We're going to edit Patrick Henry's speech. Same thing happens when you come to the Mayflower Compact. You want the Mayflower Compact, and you see it says, we whose names are, this back to 1620, we whose names are underwritten, dot, dot, dot. What do they take out? We whose names are underwritten, having undertaken for the glory of God and investment in the Christian faith, but they took out all the Christian stuff. Yeah. See, that's that deconstructionism. We're going to take out the stuff that reflects Western values, Western culture, Western institutions. Well, we're not going to talk about that type of stuff. This is omission. It is often what's called censorship. There's a great book done by the Department of Education researcher Paul Betz on this called Censorship. And I love what he said about this. He says, over and over, we've seen that liberal and secularized is primarily accomplished by exclusion, by leaving out the opposing position. It's such a bias. time to observe the cost of publication directory system, but it's the essence of censorship. It's effective not only because it's hard to observe, it just isn't there, and therefore it's hard to counteract, but also because it makes only the liberal secular position seem to be lower than false. But only the secular stuff, we're going to talk about the book, we'll edit that out. And so, what happened? Here's our quote. If I were writing an American history textbook, and I wrote in the textbook that Abraham Lincoln ended World War I by dropping a nuclear weapon on Burma, everybody would say, we're nuts. That's okay. Abraham Lincoln wasn't in World War I. We didn't have nuclear stuff back then. Burma had nothing to do with it. But if I just flat left Abraham Lincoln out of the textbook, most people would never notice because there's so many hundreds of names in the textbook. I just need to leave them out. I don't have to vilify them. I don't have to misrepresent. I don't have to lie. I just have to leave them out of the textbook. People won't even notice that he's not there. That's what happens on a regular basis. All the kind of heroes and folks and instances of history that we used to look at, we just don't put them in anymore. And that's what we do. We exclude that. Now, there's some other examples of how we also take and twist those values. Take George Washington. This is the book, Maxims of George Washington. It's currently available. You can buy this in any major bookstore. It comes from the 1855 book. The 1855 book was done by John Frederick Schroeder. And Schroeder did this book because in 1832, the first ever collection of George Washington's writings came out. Jerry Sparks was a chaplain of Congress, also a historian. He took all of Washington's letters, compiled them in a 12-volume set of Washington's writings. And people read that and said, there's a lot of wisdom in these letters. Washington wrote about 40,000 letters, by the way, so he wrote a lot. Just, there's a lot of wisdom in here. So they went to that 1832 volume, and he went through and pulled out all of Washington's political advice, all of his social advice, his moral advice, his religious advice, all these great actions. So they brought that out, and in each category, there's four categories, as they went through it, what they did was they pointed to that category and said, let us introduce you people who knew him in this area. So in politics, they brought out people who served in the first Congress, who happened to have lower rights, guys who worked for the political world. And the military section, they brought out guys who were his generals, guys who served under him. And when they got to the religious section, they brought out people who knew his faith. And so here's the start of that section. You see here, there's a statement by James Sewell. Sewell happens to be a literary guy, a poet out of New Hampshire, who's very close friends to Washington. He talks about Washington, said he was a firm believer in the Christian religion. You see here, Chief Justice John Marshall, U.S. Supreme Court, served in Washington the Revolution. He said he was a sincere believer in the Christian faith. Judge Bucknell was the president of Congress, who's actually George Washington's boss in the Revolution. He started the American Bible Society. He said the general was a Christian. You have here Jeremiah Smith, who was a federal judge appointed to the bench by George Washington. Jeremiah Smith said he was not ashamed of his Christian profession. Deborah Jarrett was George Washington's pastor here in Virginia. He said he was a professor of Christianity. Jared Sparks, who's a chaplain of Congress, said he's a Christian of faith and practice. He said, this is how they introduced George Washington to all the guys who knew him to talk about his faith, and then they give all of Washington's quotes. Now, interestingly, that's 1855, but that's the original version of the book. When it was reprinted in 1987, they took that page out. The page talked about his faith, they completely eliminated that. And what they did in its place was they put in a page written by a professor. And the professor now tells us about what written eyewitnesses. The professor tells us, he says, well, like many deists, Washington knew this. Really? Washington was a Christian with all the eyewitnesses, and now we've got a professor telling us, no, Washington was a deist. Jefferson was a deist. We get this deism stuff crammed at us. The only way you do is you have to take out the original writings. You have to take out the people who actually saw it. You have to alter the text. See, this is the book of the Bible on the shelf right now. When you read it, you say, well, Washington's a deist because Professor so-and-so said he's a deist. Go back to the eyewitnesses. See, that's deconstruction. That's chipping away those values and tearing it. So, chipping, tearing out the old surveys. The other thing is there is a steady flow of negatives. I talked about how to work with the skyscraper. Well, let me give you just a few examples. Let me take the Puritans, because in every textbook I've seen, modern textbook, we talk about how the Puritans are batshit intolerant Christians. And how do we know that they're intolerant? Because they did the witch trials. Those witch trials, that proves these guys are completely intolerant. Look at Christians that wouldn't have religious freedom and are killing people who didn't believe like. Let's talk about the witch trials a minute. You know how long the witch trials lasted? Last 2 months. 27 people put to death. And that's 27 people, too many. But the story's not the witch trials. Do you know how the witch trials came to a close? The witch trials came to a close when three Christian leaders, John Wise, Henry Smith, and Thomas Braddock, went to Governor Phipps. They went to William Phipps and said, Governor, these trials are violating the scriptural precedent on juries and evidence. And they went through the verses and said, look what the Bible says about Jesus. There's a lot of trials in the Bible. Jesus had a trial. Paul had three trials. Remember, David had a trial in front of Ahab and Jezebel. All these trials. They said, look at the biblical rules of evidence. You're not holding these up. You're doing this wrong. These people are being put to death. Three ministers went and showed the Bible. Phillips looked at that and said, you're right. He called him Judge Samuel. So he saw the trials. We're not using biblical rules of evidence. This is a bad deal. What happened was, Judge Sewell then stood up in church and repented in front of the congregation for not having followed the biblical rules of evidence, and therefore, these people were put to death. And William Phipps